got that old school diner feel.
Yeah.
With really nice walls, like the tiles and stuff. I don't know if you can see it, but like
brick face and shit.
Yeah, it's good. It's like treated wood. Looks
I like it. I like it so far. So good. I do want to do some other stuff. I want to get into some more like edited, structured, like documentary style interviews. Yeah. So I'm making some phone calls. I got a couple people I want to talk to. Ren Thomas gave me a go ahead.
Okay.
I'm gonna get with him after the new year.
See. That's an interesting like thing, is because it's like
here you go, guys. You're coming up shortly, okay?
Thank you, darling.
Terrific.
I'm starving, bro.
Oh, I had a half a bag of M&Ms this morning and 2.5 cups of coffee. And that's a half crazy. A cup of coffee was from a car dealership, and breakfast. It was just shit. You know, like they the made it yesterday. It's watered down. It's gross. This is good.
Yeah, this is good.
I'm happy.
I think car dealerships put something in their coffee, like a.
A time slower downer? Because sort of like I was there for 19 hours this morning.
Time slower downer? Some Bill Cosby shit.
I don't know
coffee,
what it was.
Bro. They make you agreeable as hell.
I just signed everything.
They just wear you down.
Everything
yeah,
I signed.
Yeah, they wear you down.
By the ninth pick, the thing that I signed, I was like, I should probably look at least what's the title of this
I
document.
I gotta be honest, when you told me you was going to buy a car, I was really writing the day off. Like, I thought you might need like a mental health day afterwards.
I thought.
I don't do well in car dealerships.
Nobody does. I did all right, I guess, because, I don't know, I think about this. It's not like I was going in to buy a box of, like, cereal, which is how I had it planned out, by the way, this morning. Because I'm like, oh, man, the guy will be there at 7. I'll get up. I'll be there.
Right.
I got up at 8:30. My dog's barking. Yo, let me out.
Oh, man.
So, no, this is good. But I wanted to talk about content versus, like, quality and that sort of thing, too, when it comes to these types of shows, because it's content's what makes me watch something. If something's funny or if somebody's like whatever, like if the audio's just that bad and it's impossible to listen to, that's one thing. But it's like
first show.
Yeah. Welcome to this episode of An Officer and Best We Could Do. No, this is like people will watch because they want to watch you and they, you know, what you're into, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh shit, and he has really good quality stuff. Right. Like I'm not gonna just watch something just because it's like all top notch, like whatever.
Absolutely.
You know? Right. So you got to do both.
Well,
you have to balance them out.
I figured that the people around me are more than interesting and compelling enough to propel what I'm doing. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, they'll carry you for sure. I did that with my podcast. Yeah, I did a podcast for quite a while. And I was just like, I know enough interesting people that I can get away with maybe saying 3 minutes worth of stuff in an hour, like, and let them carry the rest of it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, that's where I want to go. But I wanted to talk to you because you helped me a lot just in the last couple of weeks. You helped me break a barrier and go into a place that I've been wanting to go to for a while.
Yeah.
People don't know that we've been friends for a very long time.
Yeah.
One of my favorite stories is to tell how I took my driver's license test in your mom's car.
That's right.
Like, that's how far back we go.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But we have only recently reconnected and began spending more time around each other. And in that process, you helped me step into the stand-up world.
Right.
Which...
I'm so glad you did.
Some people, I'm
like, I don't want you to just because it's just not for the only other. It's just because it's just like there's the idea of like, oh, I could try that and I could do that. And that's fine. Go, you know, do it or whatever. But it's just like at the same time, too, it's like you're funny, man. And I know as long as I've known you, you've always been funny. You've had a great stage presence. And my favorite story about you, and I hope I get to tell this in like 10, 15 years when we're real successful at like, you know, selling out something like the Ritz Diner. is I've seen you at open mics like rap, I've seen you perform, I've seen pictures of you in like other places where there's like a whole bunch, like just shows I never made it to. And your confidence on stage has always been good. You're just, you know, you're a big dude. You're intimidating, you can walk down, whatever. And you got up on stage. The first time you went up and did an open mic, you get up on the stage, you didn't even lift your foot to get up on the stage, and you grabbed the mic, you're like, I instantly regret this. And I'm like, no! Inside, I'm like, you got this, I swear you could do this. And your first laugh, there's a bite that you get in any passion that you have. And that's part of the, you know, cost of doing business.
It's part of the environment.
Ambiance,
Absolutely.
It adds to it. But there's a bug that you get, and I saw that you got it when you got your first laugh. Yeah. I'm like, good. I'm glad he got it quick.
I'll never forget that. Yeah.
Good. I'm glad he got it quick because it's like, it takes a long time. It just like, I still have a lot to go too, but it's just like, it takes such a long time to really kind of get that in your head that like, I can do this. Sometimes it takes going to an open mic with a bunch of shitty comics. They're like, okay, I can definitely do that. And that's, to me, it's every open mic is always 50-50, because it's like somebody's going to come and give you all the confidence that, right, in the world, and at the same time, they're going to make you want to get right back in your, the other people are going to make you want to get right back in your car and like, dude, these people are hilarious. I can't do that. You don't have to do that. You just got to do the best you could do. Yeah. And, you know, so that's why, like, for me, a lot of the stuff that I talk about up on stage is just life experiences. So I'm not really worried about, like, I'm not, like, overprotective about material or anything like that. Or, you know, that I even think that it's, like, that golden to be like, oh, I don't want anybody to steal this joke or whatever. But it's, like, it's really hard to steal a joke that, like, when I tell a story about, like, you know,
somebody's gonna tell you a story.
My daughter watching Finding Nemo and I'm, like, starts crying. I'm like, what the fuck do I do now?
Right. Who's going to tell you
a story?
Start
doing drugs or something. Yeah. I don't know. What should I do?
See, man, like, when I write, for the most part, I write the same thing. It's from life experience. And it's not like, I don't feel like anybody's going to go up and tell my story. You know what I mean? Right. I do, what I do find myself doing is not posting as much of my stuff on Facebook anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I get ideas. I have screenshots in my phone of things that I've typed up and started to post. And it's like, nah, that's for the stage.
It is for the stage. Yeah. I notice that a lot. Yeah. And I've done that too. If like if I could look at like a scale or whatever, like the graph would definitely have gone down since I've gone on stage more. It's not that I post less. It's just like, you know, I hate to be corny and quote the Joker, but it's just like, you know, if you're good at something, never do it for free. It's the truth. So I'm like, this is a good joke.
Absolutely.
So if I put this out there, like, it's just kind of gone. Because what I don't want to have happen, and this is just me in my own head, but I don't want somebody to come and sit in the audience, hear me tell a joke, and go, oh, he just posted that on Facebook.
That's exactly why.
Maybe it's just something I got to get over, but I don't want to get over that.
I don't think it is. I don't think it is. Well, because on one hand, there's two sides of that argument. On one hand, it's like I will watch a comedy show multiple times, right?
Yeah.
But at the same time, that doesn't necessarily mean that I want to keep regurgitating the same stuff.
Right.
So, like you said, if you're talking about posting stuff to Facebook, those people are going to come and see you. You know, they're your friends.
Yeah.
And especially, like, in my position right now, people want to come out and see me. And I'm kind of like, well, you
stop,
know, just,
no,
you know.
Yep.
So it's like, when they do get to come, I don't want them to be reading the last 2 weeks' worth of Facebook posts that I put up anyway. So I save them, and I got to get up more.
I mean, you know, I'll just assume that it's the same thing. Like, you care about them, too. It's like, you know, whether they're paying you or not, I mean, if you treat them as, like, customers or whatever the hell it is, it's just like, you know, I want you to enjoy yourself when you come out to something that I invite you to, even if it's a house party.
Exactly.
You know, so, like, come to my house, like, I'm going to fill two trash cans full of 40s, I'm going to throw my furniture in the back and put a DJ in the living room. Like, we're going to have a good time.
Right.
I want people to have that, like experience where they come out. So, you know, you said You don't want people to, like, come see you right away.
Right.
I'm like that, too. It's like, you know, it's like medical school. It's like, my cousin's in medical school. I'm not going to ask him to check out my heart, you know? Like, he has no idea what he's doing. Right. I don't want to go see him just yet. And he's not going to invite me to his practice until he's ready. And it's kind of the same thing. It's like, you know.
I'm
when I'm not going up until, like, 1:30 in the morning.
Well, see, there's that, too. You know what I mean? And then, you know, every room's, a lot of the rooms that I've been in so far have been mostly comics.
Yep.
In there, just kind of like, you know, stretching their legs and trying out new stuff. So, and I don't know when I'm going either.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm doing a lot of this stuff kind of last minute, so I don't get to tell everybody. Like, Shayna wanted to come to the last one.
Okay.
And I was like, I don't even know if I'm going to go up. And then I went up. It's just like, you know what I mean? So now I look like I'm sneaking up on stage.
Right.
But you just did your first tour.
Yeah.
And I think that's dope. It was a crypto conference, because that's your thing. Did you get paid
hearing
in
you
crypto?
Just say hearing you just say
did you
just
get
did
paid
your
in
first
crypto?
Tour. Yeah, I've gotten paid in crypto. I've gotten paid in money. I've gotten paid in food. Speaking of food,
getting paid in food.
Yeah, here it
is. Apple's coming right up, babe. Okay.
All
right.
Fantastic. Thank you.
You want French toast? Let me bring the coffee over for you, okay?
Thank you.
No, you won't. Shit. I am a singing fool, boy.
I was rocking it.
Don't be cruel on the way over here, man. I'm singing to myself like I'm performing for Bobby Brown's actual audience.
You can't go wrong with Bobby Brown, though.
No. I did my first tour this year, so it's like I got to perform on stage, and like it's the exact opposite of what you just described, which is what I'm used to and what I feel like I deserve.
Here we go,
thank
baby.
You. Thank you
all
so
right,
much.
You're welcome.
Thanks a lot. Thanks, bro. Like, I'm still getting my, you know, I'm still in medical school, okay? I'm not operating on anybody yet. And then all of a sudden, somebody was like, hey, we're going to go do a tour of surgeons. Do you want to go lead it? And I'm like, yeah.
So you were, like, the headliner?
Well, for the most part, I was either, if I wasn't the headliner, I was the only comic.
Okay. So you're the headliner.
Yeah. I'm the headliner. There was one other time that I brought one of my favorite comics from Philly, this dude Lump Hamilton, who's just really, really funny. He came and he headlined the Philly show.
Oh, okay.
And I was going to have somebody else come out and do it, and I didn't mean to make Lump a second thought, but I was the first guy couldn't do it, and I called Lump up, and he was just like, he's one of them dudes that was like, tell me when and where, I'll be there.
Okay.
And if he had to crawl on the back of a bus, he would do it. Like, he would just hurry up to get there. And he came, he just rocked, and he didn't do nothing, like, no Bitcoin jokes, nothing about cryptocurrency. It was just like, we're tired. So the whole gist of the show is, back up to even kind of where it started. A friend of mine retired from a crypto.
I love this. I'm sorry.
How could you not love it, man? it's perfect. You know, we have to be put in a corner so we don't have to
bother anybody.
Yeah, bother nobody. So a friend of mine named Keith retired from a company called Nexus.
Okay.
And it's weird because any other time in an interview I've ever talked about that, I usually don't say his name. Not because I love you, Keith. Not that I have no problem with it. Just. You know, I try not to put too much people's business out there. But anyway, Keith retired from this company called Nexus. I did a stand-up set for 15 minutes at his retirement party.
Okay.
And the guy who's my now tour manager was in the audience, my friend Nate, who I've known for a little while, and he was like, dude, I go to all these conferences and I hate them. I'm putting my own together. And I want it to be like techie and like kind of whatever throughout the day, but the second half I just want it to be entertainment. So we have game shows that we do. Giveaway shit, and then I close it out with some jokes. And if I have another comic that I'll bring along, they'll either come with me, or if I have another, like if a musician wants to perform, they can.
Okay.
But I went to Baltimore, New York, New Hampshire.
Wow.
New Hampshire was fun. Portsmouth, New Hampshire, it's beautiful. And there's just, you can spend all the Bitcoin you want up there, it's nuts.
Is it a heavy crypto community up there?
Yeah, yeah. A friend of mine named Derek, man, he's from Philly. He moved up there a couple years ago, and he's the type of guy that he like would walk in with nothing in his pocket but lint and a smartphone with Bitcoin on it and be like, hi, do you take crypto? And they say, no. And he said, do you want to? And I swear, let's say 6 out of 10 of them said yes.
That's
right. So he kind of, like, he stayed in touch with them all. He's just good at, like, you know, relations with people or whatever. And ended up putting them all on this map. So you go up to Portsmouth, New Hampshire, you go to the Bitcoin Center, and there's a map where you can go and, like, buy whatever the hell you want to with Bitcoin.
Sure.
Yeah. So we went up there. Where else? Did a show in Denver, San Diego, Vegas. I'm fucking fly, man. I keep forgetting this. But no.
Well,
and then
we're
doing Florida in a couple weeks. So we're doing Florida at the end of January, maybe early February. That's true. Oakland in March. And then a bunch of Ireland is supposedly in the works.
Get out of here.
I'm gonna go to Ireland. I'm gonna get
my motherland. Yeah.
I thought with the Macmillan.
That's what's up, man.
So,
now, how did you get... Now, I know you have been a bit of an activist in the past few years. And,
Dude,
libertarian, right? Yeah. Fuck everything, right? Fucking
for the most.
Yeah.
More that
so
than anything, yeah.
It didn't strike me when I found out you were into crypto, because you're a fucking anarchist anyway.
Right.
Right? But how, can you tell me how you got into it and why and what I'm missing, because I don't get it.
Okay.
You know?
My journey was this, is like, I stopped trusting the dollar. Was it 2018? It's going to be 2019 tomorrow. I stopped trusting the dollar. I never looked at politics or like financial world or anything like that, but as a real estate agent and watching mortgage brokers and just the industry just go all up and down from 2005 until like, you know, the crash or whatever, like that whole time. And even 2005, like when things were great, quote unquote great, the reason why they were great is because it was just a giant bubble everybody was like real excited about. Mm-hmm. So stop trusting the dollar, and I started looking at where does money come from? What the hell is it? Come to find out the Federal Reserve's like a quasi-private bank.
Okay.
The hell is that? Like, how does that even work? You know? So I'm thinking long term, man, if the dollar ever collapses, I'd like to have my savings and, like, you know, wealth stored in something that's going to preserve the savings and wealth forever, right?
Okay.
So I got into precious metals. I started buying gold and silver, copper, just some other shit. And then there was a network that got started here in Philly, which is, it was called Del Valle Silver.
Okay.
A friend of mine named Karen started it, and it was just like people got to barter back and forth, and we started trading in silver.
Okay.
And it was more of like a way to just like say fuck the banks, like, you know, fuck the system, like, mm-hmm. even if it was just our own little splash in a pond, mm-hmm. whatever. It was something to do. But we started kind of losing money with silver.
Thank you.
Oh wow, that's some scrap.
Yeah, man.
We started losing money when it came to trading silver, because if silver was $15 an ounce, do you measure it all out? It was just kind of like, ah, close enough.
Okay.
But once it started to kind of get bigger, it was like, let's try something else. All of a sudden, this digital currency came out of nowhere in 2009. Like, end of 2008 was when it was put out, but 2009 it was introduced. It was used for a little bit. I didn't hear about it until maybe 2012.
Okay.
And it was just like, wait, we can just use an app and send each other money back and forth? Okay, let's try it. And the reason why it was exciting to try was because it was this decentralized currency. Nobody had any control over it. And it was just a new, exciting thing to try.
Anarchy.
Anarchy. It's just like, let's try it. It's like real deal barter.
Okay.
A couple months go by, all of a sudden Bitcoin goes from like $10 to $20 to like $100, mm-hmm. and then I'm like, oh shit. Went up again to about 1,000, crashed back down to 100, and then just kind of hovered for a little while. And then some people just lost excitement about it, because it was like, oh, well, that flopped. But it really didn't. It just kind of went dormant for a little while. Some of us got lucky when it comes to like holding on to it.
Okay.
Because the price is now averaging around like a little under 4,000.
Really?
Per coin. So somebody bought, you know, $100 worth of Bitcoin when it was a penny. They're cool now.
Yeah, they're pretty well off right now.
There's a Bitcoin pizza somebody bought when Bitcoin was like, when 10,000 Bitcoin was equal to $10, mm-hmm. somebody bought a pizza. And it has a Twitter account. And now it tells you, like, the Bitcoin pizza is now worth like $25 million. Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Like, I bought a shirt for Bitcoin.
Excuse me. Did you guys get here in a white Honda?
I'm sorry?
In a white Honda?
No. So now, do people who do crypto, like, are you like Bitcoin only? Is it, or do you diversify when it comes to that?
There's about 2,000 cryptocurrencies now,
really?
Different ones.
Now that's not fucking up the whole, like, the value.
Sure is.
Okay.
In a sense, yeah, because anybody can, like, once Bitcoin was like the first one out, other people tried to do, you know, make other cryptocurrencies. There were some that were made to kind of complement Bitcoin and kind of help it out, like something else called Litecoin, that kind of came out, and it's, but then there's other things that try to directly compete, but really can't. There's a reason why, and that's because Bitcoin is, since it's been the first one, like, make these numbers up, but imagine if there's 1 million computers around the world, there's no off button, because you got to go turn each one off to shut down Bitcoin completely.
Okay.
And let's say you start. By the time you get to your fifth one, everybody else like knows what's coming already, and it's kind of, you know, so.
Okay.
I don't know if that help you understand it at all. It's a game. It's a hell of a game. Let's try it. But it's also a reflection of the community and how many people are so like distrusting of money in general.
It's definitely been the way things have been going lately. And understandably.
I would never sit and tell anybody buy Bitcoin right now because it'll take care of you forever. I would say buy Bitcoin right now just to say you got it.
Okay.
Just to be a weirdo like me.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to buy a whole Bitcoin. You can buy like a fraction of it. You know, you can buy $10 worth. I'll give you some. You know what I mean? It's just like, not to like suck you into a world or anything like that. Or like, oh shit, now if Elle starts buying it, I know it's going to go up more. You
right.
know, it's nothing like that.
Not
it's
like
just,
that.
Yeah, try it out. Give yourself the opportunity. Don't invest more than you can afford to lose, which is just like saying.
I mean, that's basics. That's the basic. The basic theory behind investing anyway.
Yeah, but you know, it doesn't happen that way, you know? It's like drive 55
mm-hmm.
on the highway.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but you can get away with going 60. And I'm like,
there's
get
no
there, if I
around.
Go 90.
Yeah,
you
no
might crash
around.
And burn yeah. completely, but you know.
Now, on your podcast, you've been doing something recently, going around to different vendors and using the crypto. Now, are you actually Bitcoin, or you?
Remember I said there's about 2,000 cryptocurrencies?
Okay.
I have 3,000.
Good job. Way to keep shit in check there, Mike. I appreciate that.
Nice and diversified. One of them's going to take off. Well, that's what I would jokingly say about, like, I had this, like, smile on my face about, like, yeah, don't invest more than you can afford to lose, but then, like, be smart. But if you're also allow yourself to be stupid sometimes, pick up a couple other coins here, and this one's lower, I might make some extra money on this one, and let's try this out and see what happens. There's other projects that I like.
Okay.
Some, if they're just out just to be a currency and one day make you rich, mm-hmm. I might get some of it, but realistically, like, I won't put a whole lot of attention into it. Okay. But there's another one called, so here's one that I'll shill like crazy. It's called BitTube.
Okay.
And it's just like YouTube, but it's all based on cryptocurrency. And every video you upload, every time somebody watches it, every time you watch somebody else's video, you're getting paid for running the site and keeping the, like, the videos going and all that sort of thing. You get a reward off of it. So I bought, you know, I would buy into that only because I can put a video on BitTube, and it's just like, you know, it's just like a 5-Starbucks stop. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go to Starbucks. You know what I mean? Because I want to see the company do well. So if I want to see BitTube do well, I'm going to keep content there. So I like those types of investments. Like,
okay.
You know, right. I have Nikes, but I don't have any Nike stock. Right. So I'm not like...
And that's where your podcast is now, right? It's on BitTube.
Oh, so, yes. Well, you were asking before. So my friend Ken Bozak and I are, we loosely do some, like, work together as far as podcasts and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. We've had shit on the back burner for too long. But what we have done already is, so we called around to a bunch of places in Philly that we know used to take Bitcoin.
Okay.
And we're like, hey, do you still? And if they say yes, we go visit them. So one, we went to this place called Oasis Mexican Grill. It's actually in Jersey, but forgive me. Might have to cross over into enemy soil and see it. But no, we called them up. And then Ken and I recorded the car ride over. It was about 45 minutes to get there. We just recorded a podcast there. We recorded one on the way back, too. But we went in, we swiped our phones, and we paid for tacos and Bitcoin. Like, it's just, you know. And when we sit down, like, he's got a Bitcoin shirt on. We have, like, Bitcoin stickers on our phones and stuff. And the lady next to us goes, what is all that all about? What's that Bitcoin thing? Hmm. We start talking, and she's like, oh, well, can you, like, spend it anywhere? And we're like,
that's what we're
yeah. And I got to point to the right sign, now. And yeah. I was like, yeah. So it kind of, like, not that you want to shut people up, but it, like, shuts up that, like, oh, well, where can you spend it? Mm-hmm. Here.
Yeah.
Spend it right the fuck here.
Yeah, actual, you know, practical use, you know what I mean, and showing people, because I've never seen anybody use Bitcoin before. Like, I've never, you know, happened across somebody who was Bitcoining, unless it's some secret squirrel shit. You know, some handshake in the back of
the room. The thing is, you might not even know if they are. Chances are you probably haven't. But if they were, you might not know, unless it was like a...
It looks like you're using Apple Pay. Like,
you're just swiping your phone.
Yeah,
you know? Okay. And I would, no offense to vegans, I would say we're not as bad as vegans, but we're pretty close when it comes to Bitcoin, because it's like, you know... Look, I'm using Bitcoin! We take pictures, we tag nobody's, Bitcoin, or hashtag Bitcoin. Bitcoin
nobody's even in the realm with vegans, bro. Like, I won't even let you disrespect vegans like that. This dude's a fucking militant.
We're not militant about it. And it's all voluntary, and you ask anybody. It's weird, because it feels like some of them are like, no, yeah, don't buy it. Do whatever the fuck you want. Right. And you're like,
yeah, what?
I feel like I have to. Yeah. What are you doing to me?
Fucking Illuminati.
Yeah.
You guys just went and started your own Illuminati. That's all. You couldn't get in the real one, so you had to fucking...
Well, essentially, isn't that what anarchy is? It's just, you know, it's not no rules, it's no rulers. Mm. And, am I an anarchist? Am I a libertarian? Am I, you know, a voluntarist? I think I'm a combination of a few.
Okay.
It's tough to put a label on myself, but I mean, I just believe in self-ownership. I believe in, you know, being able to preserve your wealth and defend yourself and all those things. And,
so let me run it for office. Come on, man.
Never.
Come on, man. You can't be
never.
In.
Never.
You can't be out pretending to be in, man.
Never. Run from that office as fast as I can. I ran as a delegate a couple years ago in one of the presidential races, and it was just like, even that process... is insane.
You mean,
I ran as a delegate
to
be able to,
Okay.
Not in the Electoral College, but, so Democratic National Convention, a Republican National Convention, a Libertarian National Convention, which is like six people show up. But I ran as a delegate for the Republican National Convention in 2012 because I'm a Ron Paul supporter. I'm not a Republican. I'm not a anything. It's just like I liked that guy and his ideas. He just happened to run as a Republican. He just happened to, you know, that's how he ran. So in order to get him voted in, I ran as a delegate here in Pennsylvania to get sent down to Florida to go vote for him.
Okay.
I came in fourth. The top three people win.
Really?
Yeah. The first guy that won, he just wrote a giant check and got all his votes. I swear to God, because I didn't see no campaigning at all, man.
You
got to
get a bigger check, right?
Yeah. So.
Like one of those publishers' clearinghouses.
Yeah. A real big one. So, but even how that got handled, we had somebody that went up to Harrisburg and watched them count all those votes and all that stuff too, and just even how that was handled was ugly. I still went down to the convention anyway. I rode my bike all the way down to Tampa. Still went down anyway, and that was ugly. Like, and it was just all just really bad. So it's just like, the closer I got into politics, the closer of a look I got and really how disgusting it was for me. And I'm the type that I was just like, look, I could get hit by a bus tomorrow, I got a kid, you know, I got a family, like, I'd just rather focus on that. And that's just kind of where I went from there. I'm not big on governance, or government that much, really.
I would think that would be the reason to run, though, right? That's why you go.
It could be.
But it's almost like from the inside, right? That's why I became a cop. Destroyed the establishment from the inside.
They're doing a fantastic job.
That's why I want to become a comedian.
See?
Tear this shit down, man. You motherfuckers in here ain't funny.
I love comedy because it's just a chance to go. Like, you can go and try to be political and like, oh, I got a clever thing to say. This will change the world, and then you'll get humbled. Or you just kind of go up and just whatever. But I mean, I've told plenty of Bitcoin jokes in front of non-crypto crowds just to try it, to see if, not to see if I could bomb, but like to see if it would just, you know, see where it goes. And they're good. Those people laughed. So I'm like, okay, they get it.
I just want to do it because I feel like this shit, people just need to fucking know.
You know what I mean?
People are acting like they don't know shit. And it's like, no, people are assholes. You know what I mean? Pull your shit together. This is what real life is like. It's okay.
It's okay. People have to realize that it is okay. I'm like this. I have that too. I have this, like, not like I feel like I have a duty to like help the world, but this is more for me than anything. Like, my cousin died 2 years ago, almost to the day, 2 days ago. We were really, really close, and it was just like he went to sleep. He had an aneurysm. He just went to sleep and then never woke up. And it was just like, what the fuck? It's not like he was like shooting himself up. It's not like, it just happened. And I've always told him, like, him and I used to talk almost every day on the phone, just like stupid shit back and forth. And I'm like, yo, one day I'm gonna get up on stage and I'm gonna use like all this shit, you know? Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I went up a few times before he passed away, and he's, you know, whatever. He saw me perform once. But then after he died, I was like, I lost him. Not too long after, I got arrested, and I got arrested with one of my best friends in the world, who I really wasn't like supposed to be around because of the arrest after that too. And I was just like, just kind of keep your distance. So it's like I was almost like forced away from him, just like other people in my life that have just like didn't always like last too long. This recurring theme of like nobody's fucking sticking around. Right. It's like really starting to settle in after a while, and I'm like, does anybody even give a shit? I don't think I do. Fuck this. And then the more snarky I got, the funnier I was becoming to myself.
Absolutely.
And I was like, this has to get out. So the amount of frustration that just kind of like disappears after you say, oh shit, I just left that on stage and it was funny, and they laughed at it because they can relate.
Yeah.
My absolute favorite joke that I used to tell that I don't tell anymore, and I won't tell it here, but it's just like, I got up on stage, and the first time that I got the, like, I just got this laugh from some dude. It took him about 4 seconds for it to really sink in. Like, a couple people laughed, and then when it really sunk in, he went, oh, shit. And I was like, thank you. Because it was just like, all right, good. Like, I know I hit somebody in that same chord. That, and it was about something dark, but it was just like, good. It's work.
I had one like that the last time, the last open mic we did at the coffee shop. And one guy in the back, just threw one out. Like a whole, the whole, I mean, I was like, is this dude just being a weirdo? Or, you know, and then he came to me when I got off stage, and he told me why it hit him so hard. Right? Yeah, and it was, you know, that it meant a lot to me. I think that I've always had, like, you know, I've always performed. So I think I've been looking for the next way to be okay performing. I'm gonna be 41 in a couple of months. I just don't know if I need to be rapping at people like I used to. You know what I mean?
Weird. Certain guys can definitely pull it off for sure. Like there's a lot of MCs that would just still come out, walk on stage, and the whole crowd would just go nuts.
I feel like I needed to go a lot harder like 20 years ago in order to still be able to be that guy today. And I just didn't, and I gotta kinda realize that.
Sure.
But I'm not done. You know what I mean?
No,
you're not. I don't feel like I'm done. And I think that this gives me the opportunity to, you know, to keep going, you know, but
I had my answer in my head, but is it harder? Is this harder?
No.
No?
No.
What's different? See, I like when I'm wrong.
No, I think the difference is, at least so far, the people, in the places I perform so far, what I find is like a comedy open mic is so different than like a hip hop show, because I don't feel like the other comedians are watching you and sizing you up.
You haven't been to enough open mics yet, but yeah,
that may be the case. But at least so far, I don't feel that like you get at a hip hop show. You know what I mean? Who the fuck is this boy? Is he done? You know what I mean? Nobody want to actually go along with you. Right. I feel like in a comedy surrounding, people go with you often than they do in a hip hop show. Even fans, like even people who are actually like not even other artists, they go with you. Right. You know what I mean? In hip hop, it don't seem it's harder. At least it has been for me.
I get that. I think coming up with that type of attitude is maybe that's kind of in my head too, because when I see, like, I'm not saying every other open mic that you haven't been to is going to be like that. There will be some that are like that. For me, maybe I think it's kind of in my head a little bit too, because I expect that from most people in my interaction through life. Like, fucked up with this dude, you know? Oh, shit, okay, you can do something. But, like, especially when I see other comics that, like, I'm like, this dude's fucking funny as shit. I'm like, oh, shit, he's in the room. Like, I get that. I still get that. Like, oh, shit, he heard this joke. Like, it doesn't go away. If you admit and embrace that, it's fine. I guess maybe hip hop, you have to be like tougher.
And then on top of that, it's like, I don't even know if I'm allowed to say it myself, but I'm polarizing anyway. You know what I mean? Like if you know who I am and what I do, and then you see me, you know, doing this or rapping or doing comedy somewhere, like I almost deserve the, what are you doing here? You know, it's almost like I almost bought that. You know what I mean?
I kind of like it because it really forces me to be like
you guys
to come out.
Over here?
We are. Thank you very much. It forces me to show that. Mm-hmm. Like it kind of forces like who the fuck is this dude? Mm-hmm. Let me show you. Mm-hmm. I am in a sense mm-hmm. like, I don't know. Yeah, the hip hop. I guess like having to be like a little bit tougher or whatever is maybe a little bit different. I don't know. I think this is the support's there for sure, but everybody still wants to be the one that's gonna like shine.
Absolutely.
I don't know if it's the same because now since you can have your own show, like you're just doing your own show. It's not like you're not competing to be the number one Netflix show right now. Yeah. They're not competing against
not right
like,
now.
Not yet. Couple more weeks. But since we can kind of all do this, like. I think I heard somebody say not too long ago, like, you don't really need a million fans. Like, as long as you got, like, 50, 60,000 that'll constantly, like, whatever, you can eat off that for a long fucking time.
For a very long time, absolutely. Yeah.
So I look at my friend Ken Bozak is, he looks like a clown. He's got a giant red beard. He wears a pink fanny pack, a red one, or, like, an orange one, and then maybe a black one. He's not sure. Just depends on which way the day is blowing.
Right.
He'll come out in slippers. He'll come out in, like, whatever. Dude that grew up on Armingo Avenue and just would probably knock anybody out that says anything horrible about him. Yeah, but, like, he can be himself.
About this pink fanny pack.
And he doesn't have to... it's forgivable. But, like, he doesn't have to adapt or mold or become anybody else in order to become the next, like, whatever. He's got enough fans already. He's got enough, like, whatever already. Enough momentum to be able to push himself. And, you know, I hope he takes off. I hope he becomes, like, you know. Vinny Paz is an amazing example of that, too. I mean, here's a dude who was just like, look. Have you ever seen him on the cover of The Source? Have you ever seen him on MTV? Have you ever even... Most people haven't even heard of him.
Man, fucking rock star.
Goddamn rock star. Fucking and the reason star. He's a rock star yeah. is because he just chucked at it.
Yep. You refuse
discipline... My God, that show with him on Joe Rogan, that's like his discipline of like, nope, right, 5 nights a week.
Yeah.
I'm in the studio every goddamn Thursday, and I was just like, yeah, no matter what.
Yep.
Now, when it comes to like comedy writing, what I've gotten better at was like... I would block off the time, be like, all right, Sunday morning, I'm going to hook myself up. I'm going to, like, 8 in the morning till like, whatever, 11. I'm going to lock myself in a room, and I'm going to write. Well, come 8 o'clock, where's the inspiration? It doesn't just show up
for you, yeah.
So I just take a bunch of material that I've, like, I'll write stuff down on my phone, I'll do this, but then I'll bring it back during those 3 hours in the morning, and it's like, I'm just re-editing. Even if I'm writing the same shit 15 different times, because another word will come out. Look. Why I love comedy so much is because it makes me laugh. I love the laugh.
Yeah, that's
I
the that, fucking that's love it. It. That's just, the root. Yeah, that's it.
So, if I'm laughing, like, I heard Louis C.K. say this. They're like, all right, "What's your process of writing?" He's like, "Well, I think of something, and when it makes me go, I write it down."
I write it down.
But it's that simple. And if I'm like, "Oh, shit,"
so my writing. I think my writing process so far has been because I've been kind of refraining from posting a lot of stuff publicly. I think that when I find myself thinking of something funny to write on Facebook, instead I write it in my notepad.
Yeah.
And I kind of put them together. I was telling you before that the thing I had the hardest time doing is practicing. Mm-hmm. Like I really feel silly. Like, because I haven't, it's been years since I would just sit around and like rap to myself or just write a rap. I used to write my raps while I was driving. I didn't write raps down from the time I left high school in 96 until about 2014.
Oh, wow.
I did not write raps down. What I would do is I would memorize them and I would drop them into a voice recorder.
Oh, okay.
And listen to them. I would do that. I have a very hard time doing that with jokes because it's like, who the fuck are you talking to?
Here's when that's hard for me. If I'm just driving and I'll talk to myself or whatever, I'm like, you know, I'll get stuff out and I'll like write that way. Mm-hmm. Then when I go, shit, it's always a second thought to put the voice recorder on after.
Mm-hmm.
So after then I'm like, after, even if I say 4 words out loud, I go, right. Oh shit, it's not recorded. Mm-hmm. And then I go,
You bomb in your own fucking car.
I'm like, yeah.
Yeah. That's hard for me. It's hard. And I got to get past that. But it's like, I don't even know who I'm embarrassed to at this point. I'm just embarrassed to myself.
You're just embarrassed.
Yeah, I'm just embarrassed. Like, I don't want to practice a fucking joke. Right. You know what I mean? I let Shayna read some stuff. Like, she'll laugh. That's when I know I got a good one.
Okay.
I send you stuff.
Yeah.
And you laugh.
Yeah.
Like, if you could laugh at this shit written, then I know I got it. I got something good.
Yeah.
But in order to be able to come across with it on stage, like, I know I need to practice, but I feel like a complete jit bag just sitting around fucking telling myself a joke.
You have to embrace your jit bagness because here's what happens. You'll tell a joke. I've told the same joke on stage, let's say the fourth time, but the fifth time you tell the joke, a better synonym comes up.
Mm-hmm.
Something better that just hits better. You're like, why didn't I say that before? Yeah. Oh!
No, that's
and now it's like this new, like, and that's why it helps to, during that 3 hour editing, like every Sunday morning or like whatever it is for me at night, like I'll lock myself in my room. And even if there's no inspiration, there's times, man, because listen, I'll tell you what I do. I waste a lot of time. I know all 10 things about Willy Wonka that you didn't know. I watch so much bullshit on YouTube. It's ridiculous.
Yeah,
15 things about Back to the Future that you never probably didn't know. I know them too. I know all the alternative possibilities of the Matrix and all that. I'm just saying. So, like, it comes to a point where I got to shut the screen off. Yeah. And just look here, old school, click the pen, like, you know, and start writing. And even if it's just me rewriting the same thing,
Are you a pen and paper dude?
Oh, yeah.
You fucking 1984?
Yeah.
Dude, no, fuck that.
No, I have to. I have to because it's, well, one, I can't write fast enough. Sometimes I'll type stuff out. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I will do a voice record, like if I think of something. Mm-hmm. But then I don't have a problem listening to myself, but mm-hmm. it's just like, I don't know. Sometimes it just works better if I just write it out. But yeah, I'm old.
That's old school.
Oh, it's bad. I have a box where I throw all my like notes and all kinds of stuff in.
Dude, that's not green at all, bro. You're an anarchist, like eco-terrorist.
Yeah, but
with the fucking notebooks.
But I know where the trees are coming from. You know what I mean? What's green about smoking pot? Nothing. It's, you know, you're destroying vegetation, but you're regrowing. No, yeah. It's not that green, but whatever. It takes more energy. You know, it takes just as much energy when you do a Google search.
Yeah.
Starting a rocket ship. I just made that up.
It makes sense. Yeah, it's about the same thing. Google search, nuclear explosion, same thing. Yeah.
It's true. But I do. I read through. And even like even just reading, like the third time come out, and I'll say it out loud. I'll time it. Mm. I stop timing as much because you really notice, like, especially in the beginning, where it's like, all right, you only get 3 minutes.
Right.
So, my God, I was so stressed out because my set was 3 minutes and 19 seconds long. And I was like, I can't cut them down.
How do I cut the last?
I need to
talk faster.
I went up to the guy before. Like, this is my first time at this one open mic. I was like, listen, I'm at like 3 minutes and 19 seconds. And I can't imagine, like, on the inside.
What he was thinking.
He was probably like, what the fuck?
What the fuck is this guy?
Go away from me, man.
That's
what's your 19
you know
seconds?
What was intimidating to me was the last open mic we did at the coffee shop, and they were like 5-6 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what am I supposed to talk about for 5 to 6 minutes?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I'm only 40 years old. I don't have that many fucking stories to tell. You know what I mean? But then the bit I did, and I didn't realize it was that long. It was like a 4.5, 5.5 minute bit. I was like, oh, that was perfect. Mm-hmm. It was actually perfect. But I was really, like, I got shook up thinking it was going to be too much time. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Not that people mind you getting the fuck off stage a little bit,
yeah.
You know? But I had to come to that. I had to come to that realization too. But I don't know, man. It's been a lot of fun, and it's something I want to do more of. I like it way more than I thought I would.
Me too.
I like it a shitload more than I thought I would, and I want to do some more. But I owe it to you. I owe you because I have a lot of friends. I have a lot of friends who are actually comedians, like many. You know what I mean? But for some, I don't know what I was waiting for, but I thank you.
The reason I hit you up and reached you, you're welcome. But the reason I reached out to you is because, yeah, these videos, these man listen videos you do. If you don't watch this man, if you're watching this, just hit subscribe. Yeah, these man listen videos you do are funny.
Yeah.
There's a good structure to it, mm-hmm. and you always keep it under a minute. And was that because, I wanted to ask you, was that solely because of Instagram's 60-second limit?
It started out because of Instagram. The last couple have been a little longer.
All right, but that's what's up, because
because I'm going more to YouTube with them, so I'm stretching them out a little bit more. But it was because of Instagram.
But you're still keeping them brief.
I wanted to be able to get the whole thing up, yeah.
I like that. It's like that whole, like, within, I think Twitter went up now, but it was like, say what you got to say in 140 characters.
Yep.
That's it. 3 minutes on the mic. That's it. That's all you've got. So, you know, you can go back and you can look and you can count all your ums
mm-hmm.
and you could say, all right, well, there's a minute and a half.
Yeah, there you go.
Back.
That's gone. Yep.
Yeah. There's a lot of, you know, it's just a lot you can do.
But I started doing those because I wanted to practice writing and I wanted to practice editing.
Right.
And I didn't have anybody else to shoot.
Right.
So it was just like,
I'll
just shoot me.
And we all get these ideas of like, what? Wait a minute.
Yeah, why are we doing it? Yeah, how's that cool? That's like, that's what I wanted to do. Yeah.
There was one really specifically that I was just like, this belongs on the stage. It was your delivery. It was the point. It was, I know which one it was. It was when you were like, it was the one about losing your mind. Because lost a button.
I lost a button.
So not to redo the whole minute video, but you were like, I walk into works. I'm about to like, oh, you lost a button. You're like, yo, people lose all kinds of shit. You think I'm worried about a button? And the funniest part at the end was when you were like, some guy asked me for change. He lost his damn mind.
You think I'm worried about a button?
I was like, oh my God, this is so funny. And that's why I was like, boy, have you ever given any thought to going on stage? And you're like, yes. You want to do this.
Yeah.
I know you do.
Yeah. I think I was just waiting for that one next step of validation.
Right.
And it came from somebody I genuinely trust. And that's when I decided I'd go ahead and do it. That was cool.
We were talking about this before. There's an old story. I'll just fast forward the whole thing. But some guy wanted to start some business. And he's like, has no idea where to even start. And he's walking down the street. And he passes an old man on a bench. And the old man says, hey, son, come sit down. Talk to me. Tell me all about you. Kid tells him his whole story. And he's like, I want to start this business. And the guy goes, here. Pulls out a check, writes a $10,000 check to the guy and says, don't cash this until you absolutely need it. But I promise you, you're going to be successful. He said, this is here just in case you need it. So the guy was like, all right. And he never cashed the check. So for that year, he just grinded and grinded and grinded. He became really, really successful. Years later, he went back and he went to go see this old man to give him back the check. And he went back to the nursing, it was a nursing home. And the nurse comes up and says, oh, I'm sorry, he passed away a couple years ago. And he said, oh, I had this check. And she goes, oh, honey, he does that to people every day. He's like out of his mind or whatever. So I kind of thought of that too, because I'm a new comic, man. I'm just still getting my feet wet with all this. So when you told me that, you're like, yo, man, thanks, you're like the inspiration. I'm like,
hey, boy, you got no idea.
Well, shit. I don't even know if this is the right thing to do. And I'm going, go.
Blind leading the blind, man. It's cool.
But it's not the blind leading the blind. I know what you got at stake, and you know what you can and can't do with yourself. Absolutely. I just think you're funny. I'm like, fuck, get on stage, man. Try it out.
I'm still going, man.
Good.
I'm still going. We gotta get out a little bit more.
We will, man. I have to, because I don't have anything lined up. I have no material for my next show in Florida. So I've got in my head, I'm always like, I don't. Yeah. My friend Nate would tell me this, like,
you'll doubt yourself more than anybody.
When we went to New Hampshire, I did 2 days. I did 2 lunches. So it was like 25 minutes each day, the same crowd. So I was like, I have to do all new material. So I basically did an hour.
Oh, wow.
I didn't repeat one joke.
No shit.
And Nate pointed that out to me afterwards, because all day before the first day, I was so nervous and freaked out because... I don't know if he was giving us a gift.
The $10,000 check.
$10,000 check, yeah. Banging, right there. We're going to the bank to sign this joint. Nate comes up to me and he's like, yo, are you cool? And I'm like, I don't know that I have enough here. And he's just, will you shut up? Like, I've been watching you all year.
Yeah.
You got plenty. I'm like, whatever.
Hey, whatever you say, bro.
And it is. It's that, like, Duck is like going crazy under the water. You don't see his feet, but he just looks all calm or whatever. And you just kind of got to be there. So I did. I threw my hood up. Limb for Limb came on. Vinny Paz's joint. Okay. So I was like, all right, this is getting me hype. And then the other joint. What's the one with Eamon? Boy, you better hide the hunt than you. Whatever the fuck song is. But shout out to Eamon, man. Dude,
listen,
I wish I could sing like that, dude.
Listen,
I try,
I'm
but
sorry.
I can't.
I'm glad you brought it up. Golden Rail Motel.
Best album in the 21st century.
Unfucking believable. Unbelievable. I just had this shit on the gym day before yesterday.
Okay.
Like, I work out to that album. I work out to that shit.
Before Bobby Brown's Don't Be Cruel came, I'm riding down Ron Street. And right before Don't Be Cruel was Greatest Mistake.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, God, I feel bad for anybody that's next to me when that song comes on.
It's fucking dumb.
Oh, yeah. I just sing my ass off.
Yeah.
And you know what else? So I shot him a message. This is funny, too, because... Okay. I don't know him. I've never met him. I just saw that he's friends with Vin, and his old song about, fuck you or whatever was funny. And then the song that he started doing with Vinny, the one about the ball, whatever it is, all these songs that he'd been doing, I'm just like, you're amazing. Then I started to follow him and see his story. And the one song, You and Only You, which is about his drug addiction, I'm like, that whole Golden Rail Motel, he walked you through his life.
The whole thing.
And I'm like... Here he is on top. It's just like, I love these second chance stories.
Yeah.
Oh my God. My favorite person in the world to listen to is Joey Diaz, as a comedy coach, as just like a guy in life who's just been through a shitload and is still fucking
stories.
Amazing stories. And I always I love those comeback stories and this, just you can do it again and be kind of successful. Mm-hmm. Eamon is amazing.
I'm having some more coffee, okay, for you?
I'm actually good, dog.
You good, babe?
Yeah, we're good.
Yeah,
for
we're good. All right, yeah.
Thank you.
You all done with this or do you want another
coffee? Yeah, no, I'm good. Thanks.
All right.
So, I like seeing those things because that gives me, hope.
Mm-hmm.
And that gave me a lot of hope, too, even through comedy, too. Mm-hmm. It was like, I can start something new.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm only 40.
Yeah.
I still got both my feet, man.
Yeah.
What am I complaining about?
That was my whole theory when it came to even this, the video stuff. It was just kind of like, well, why not? Like, who's stopping you?
Here's the dangerous part of comedy. I only need my brain and my mouth. So I don't really care if I ever break my legs or my... So now I'm a little bit more free to just kind of just fuck around and do whatever,
You always do it.
Here's what I wanted to say. So one of the shows that I did in Vegas... So I did a show out in Vegas when I was out there in November. And then I met somebody who was like, yo, you're really funny. What are you doing tomorrow night? Nothing mine. He's like, oh, I'm having this elaborate dinner, and I'd love to have you as like a comic or whatever. This kid spent ridiculous money on this party.
Right.
Whatever. I got there, and hung out. I didn't eat, just goofed off, met some really cool people, really cool pictures, really nice views up on like this high rise floor. And my joke was, they're like, you know, everybody, it's when I'm at business, like it's all business. Everybody always comes up to you and they're like, what are you into at these crypto conferences? Because they want to know, like, can they, either can you sign on, can you give them money, or like whatever. So everybody would come up to me and be like, hi, how you doing? So what's your business about? I'm like, I'm a comedian. And they just stare.
Right.
So the joke that I said to all these people at this party, I was like, a lot of people have been coming up to me asking me, like, what's your business? And I say, I'm a comedian. They just, like, look at me, like, then what? And I go, here, let me give you an example of how hard I've been working. We've all been at this conference for the past 3 days. Mm-hmm. I've been at work for 45 seconds. And it's awesome. It's just awesome. I get to do whatever I want. Every show, I bring my skateboard.
Dude, what are you doing fucking skateboarding?
Just skateboarding, man. I'm just having a good time, man.
Please don't fall, bro.
Oh, I fell yesterday. Oh, I fell a bunch of times. That's my heel up. Imagine.
I used to skateboard when I was younger.
Where? In my teens. Everyone, when they were 8.
Like 12, yeah. 13. And the year I stopped, I had a homie. It was like me, my boy Brian, Kenny, this one kid named Bar. Do not know Bar's real name. It might be his real name. I have no idea, but he was like the Madonna of the neighborhood. He only had one fucking name. His name was Bar.
Yeah.
And my man Sean. And we used to skateboard together all the time. We'd go down to community college, go downtown, the art museum, and fucking skateboard. I never knew so much as how to ollie. Like, I couldn't fucking ollie, I couldn't do shit. I would just like ride with them.
Right.
But one day, they were all out riding and I wasn't with them. The story goes, my man Sean did a rail slide, lost his footing, skateboard popped up, hit him in his nuts. And allegedly, he lost one of his nuts. I actually have never been on a skateboard since the fucking day. I don't know if it's true. I haven't seen Sean again. Sean, he could have died. I don't fucking know. I haven't seen him since.
And who knows what happened to Bar?
I know what Bar is.
Oh my God. Yeah, it hurts, man. It's just like anything, you know? It's what's interesting about it now is, like, you know, when we were younger, we would hear about, like, older men going together every weekend and, like, going golfing or something like that. Me and my two of my friends that I grew up with, like, since kindergarten, we went out yesterday with, like, past couple months have been a little tough, but I mean, we never miss a week. It's like every weekend we're out, you know, and it's just, it's amazing. You don't want to have your phone in your pocket because if you fall on it, you break your $700 phone. Yeah, it's like, man, throw that off to the side. Everything goes away.
Do you have like a Tony Hawk skateboard or some shit like that? What do you do? He was on Casey Neistat show, like this week, like something he dropped a couple days ago. Tony Hawk. He's worth $700 billion
and shit.
Fucking skateboard. He probably still got both his nuts, too.
He might. I don't know. We don't really talk about it. Nobody ever really mentions it. Like, so I left my nuts.
I'm telling you right now, fuck that. Fuck every ounce of that.
That's a very good reason to never want to accept it. No, I hear you.
All I needed was the slightest rumor. Nobody ever had to tell me a second time.
No.
I didn't confirm it. That's it. I rap. That's it. I'll never lose one of my balls.
Rappers get shot.
Man, don't fuck say. That.
Nah,
man.
Nah, not as duck. Much. Yeah.
Not if you can duck. Fuck that. Fuck that.
You can duck.
Let's get the hell out of here.
All right,
bro.
Yo.
Thank you, man.
Pleasure, man.
I appreciate it. My man.